Well, with me now is Sonny Verghese, and he is the CEO of Olam International, and he's also the chair of the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. So, Sonny, lovely to meet you. Where does responsibility for going forward and looking after the environment and taking sustainability forward, where does that start? Where does it lie?
I think it starts with the individual. We all need to be the change that we want to see in others. So if it doesn't start with the individual, I don't think there's anything else that we could do, realistically. But the second level of the change is at the company level, so at the firm level. So as companies, we need to know our carbon footprint and our water footprint and our waste footprint and be committed to doing more with less resources. The third level of change has to occur at the sector level. So even if you change individually and our companies change, but our sector does not come together in an unusual sort of collaboration to develop a sectoral roadmap, in my case, it's the food and agribusiness sector, on how can we produce more food, feed, and fiber to feed a growing population of 9.5-10 billion people without destroying the planet. So we need the sector to come together. And that's a tough challenge because we are intensely competitive.
Yeah, you're rivals, aren't you?
We are rivals, and we don't trust each other, don't come together on anything. So unless there's a real crisis, and today for me, it's no longer a climate crisis. I believe we are in a climate emergency now. And therefore, the world is literally melting down. We need to come together. The fourth level of change has to occur in terms of unusual collaboration, but this time with the NGO sector and the civil society sector. We treat each other with mutual suspicion and spend a lot of money and effort to keep each other at bay. Mm-hmm. I don't think we can really change the world unless we come together to find a collective solution to these problems. The fifth change has to be the governments and policymakers have to come to the party. So if carbon is free, we're going to pollute indiscriminately. And unless the governments come and impose a carbon tax at a sufficient level to incentivize good behavior and reduce pollution, that would be an important feature. But that's just the starting point. Beyond the tax, the governments and policymakers should insist that all companies and even individuals should disclose their footprint. Let's start with the companies, they have the resources to map their footprint. There should be mandatory disclosure of footprints.
Okay, and what's the sixth level then?
And the sixth and final level is really researchers and innovators and academicians will have to come together to find new breakthrough solutions, whether it's using digital technologies, artificial intelligence, robotics, all of that technology that is available, we need to leverage that to find combinations and solutions that can address this problem.
How many people do you at Olam International employ worldwide, roughly?
We employ about 74,500 people worldwide.
Now, that's a lot of people, 74,500 people. Each of those 74,500, from what you've just said, needs to take responsibility. It starts with them. Are you confident they have accepted the message? And if not, what do you do to try and convince them?
Absolutely. The first thing to start with is really we all buy into a common purpose, a shared purpose. And our purpose is to reimagine global food and agricultural systems because we believe that we cannot feed a growing population of 9.5-10 million people without destroying the planet in terms of having to feed or clothe them or provide feed for them. So how do we do more with less resources? And people come to work to Olam, in Olam today, because they feel that all of the overwhelming effort that we ask them to put in the company is going to mean something. And it's not about selling more cocoa or coffee, which is our business, but it really means that we can really change the world in some form or manner and contribute to reimagining global food and agricultural systems. So that is the starting point. So how did we sort of embed this? So this purpose was a bottoms-up process. Because we believe that you can develop a satisfied employee population if you deliver four propositions to them. That is, first, you train them and equip them with the skills and capabilities that they need to do their roles effectively. Mm-hmm. Secondly, you get out of the way and don't put too much bureaucratic interference after you've trained them and equipped them with the skills and capabilities.
Let them blossom.
Let them do their jobs. Yeah. But third, you have to give them a clean and safe working environment. And fourth, you have to pay them a fair wage. If you do these four things, you have satisfied employees. But we have found productivity of satisfied employees roughly 75%. The trick is, how do you move your employee population from being satisfied to being truly engaged? That's a whole different ballgame altogether.
How successful are you at that?
We have got engagement scores in the high 70s, which if you compare in a population base that we have, is quite remarkable to have achieved that. And in order to have engaged employees, we need to make sure that firstly, we give them some autonomy in their roles. If they feel they're a part of a self-directed team, they feel engaged and motivated. If they feel they don't have autonomy, they don't get engaged. Secondly, we need to give them opportunities to master the skill. They got to say that the company gave me opportunities so that I'm a better risk manager today, or a farm manager, or a factory manager, or an HR manager than I was last year. And if they see that they're maturing as professionals and mastering the skill, they get engaged. The third thing that we have to do is that they have to feel that they're part of an extraordinary and winning team. If they feel they're part of a losing team or don't have a large ambition or agenda to be part of, then they don't get engaged. And finally, they have to feel that their roles and the output that they generate is going to impact the company and make a difference. If you do these four things, you have an engaged population. Productivity doubles. But the ultimate holy grail for us is, how do we get them inspired? How do we get them to come to work on the balls of their feet? They'll wake up in the morning, they really want to come to work. Less than 1% of the world's company have truly inspired employees. And to get employees inspired, you need to give them a purpose, and you need to give them some meaning in the work that they do. If you're not able to give them that purpose, they can be engaged, your productivity is quite high, but if you can get them inspired, your productivity goes up to 250%. There's no chance in hell I can oversee a company of this size, 74,500 people in 66 countries, by systems and processes and oversight and controls. There's no chance. I can only do it if they really truly feel that they own the piece of business that they're running, and there is a larger game here, or a larger purpose here, in terms of asking and demanding so much of them, in terms of the discretionary effort that they put in.
Okay, I want to move on to your role as the chair of the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. Imagine this is a job interview.
Yeah.
I'm head of the council, and I want to see whether you're up to scratch, whether you can do the job. Give me your elevator pitch. Why you? What do you bring to the party? Forget all your business, forget everything else.
Yeah.
You, Sonny Verghese, what do you bring?
Firstly, I'm authentic about the vision and the belief that we all need to play our part in transitioning our world into a more sustainable world. And particularly, I believe that unless private sector joins the fray and the party, we can't achieve it. It is a difficult job for the multilateral agencies like the UN to come up with the UN SDGs or the Paris Climate Accord or the Biodiversity Convention. That is a miracle in itself. But beyond those grand pronouncements and the grand vision, how do you really translate that into action? So unfortunately today, the UN SDG goals were set up in 2015. We need to achieve those targets by 2030. We are 3 years now into that program. So the UN's organization, SSDN, has looked at what is the progress on the first 3 years of the plan. And they have said that not one out of the 194 countries that have signed up to the plan is going to meet those targets, right? Mm. So unless private sector steps in and supports the implementation, there's a massive action gap. So what we want and what we desire the future of the world to be is clear. So that gap is filled. But whether we can actually translate that into action is a big question mark. So my belief is that we have to get the private sector involved if you want to really translate these bold goals and high ambition into real action. And I feel that I can set an example as part of the private sector. And much of the sensibility on sustainability is in the West. Asia has really been focused on growth and generating jobs and generating higher GDP and per capita incomes. So coming from Asian region and as the first non-European head of WBCSD, it's a strong signal that the rest of the world will have to follow the European example and also come to the party. And therefore, I think my getting appointed as a WBCSD chair in a way provides that signal.
Yeah, it's a message.
Yeah, it's
okay.
A message.
So you mentioned the private sector quite a few times there in your answer. What do you need from companies like Bühler, and what are you getting from Bühler at the moment?
So first is, how do we come together in a pre-competitive alliance and without any threat of each of our individual companies? How do we find a platform where we can exchange best practices, learn from each other, so that we average up our standards? Mm-hmm. And because we are multi-sectoral, the 200 companies that are members of the WBCSD, together we account for $8.9 trillion of revenues. We employ more than 19 million people worldwide. So, and we represent every sector: oil and gas industry, big pharma, food and agriculture, all sectors, transportation, all sectors. So therefore, bringing together a cross-section of the world's multinationals with that reach and influence, and getting all of us to average up our standards and learn from each other and the best practices. But more importantly, we are practice-biased and action-biased. We are not a multilateral developmental agency. It's not about a think tank. So we want to develop practical solutions that CEOs can implement in their companies, which is why it is a CEO-led council. Mm-hmm. We want the CEOs on the table. We don't want the other people from the company coming and saying, we got to check back with our board, with our CEOs.
Yeah.
So the CEOs on the table, there is no escape from committing themselves.
Understood.
So I think it is definitely a catalyst in ushering in the transition to a more sustainable world from the private sector.
Well, let me take you back to Olam International. Now, you recently divested your assets in sugarcane.
Yes.
Is that because sugarcane is too intensive in resources to grow,
yeah,
or is it purely a business decision?
So it is a combination of two things. Firstly, it is a sustainability-led decision. So we believe that sugar, from a health and nutrition standpoint, is got constraints and issues. So we have invested in a company which develops natural high-intensity sweeteners to replace artificial sweeteners. That, we think, from a health and nutrition platform standpoint, is the right thing to do and is at the core of our brand, which is about having sustainability at the heart of our business. So we think that sugar and excess sugar and food is not, from a health and nutrition standpoint, the best route or pathway as far as our portfolio and selection of products into our portfolio, rules of portfolio selection is concerned. The second is, what is our winnability? So we have winnability in niches, but it is difficult to win globally in that business unless we invest substantially additional capital to make that possible. So given both these factors of the health and nutrition issues and therefore the sustainability related issues and the investments that are required to build global winnability, we felt that we should deprioritize that business and exit the sugar business.
Well, if I may wind up by asking you to look to the future,
yeah,
and how you see your role as the chair of the World Business Council for Sustainable Development developing, if I,
yes,
can use that word,
yes,
how you see it going forward and how you will know, yeah, when you've actually made a difference.
Yes. So first, we are trying to achieve systems transformation in six meta systems. And these six meta systems correspond to the grand challenges that we face as a society. So first is to address climate and energy system. That's one big meta system. We need to fix it and make it more sustainable. Low carbon intensive energy and climate systems. And as I said, climate today for me is no longer a crisis, it's an emergency.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a big difference between a climate crisis and a climate emergency. And we have to therefore act rapidly. The second meta system that we want to change is the circular economy. Everything from plastic is one example of it. But how do you recycle and therefore build a circular economy? That's the second big meta system. So we just launched the Alliance for Ending Plastic Waste. 40 companies have signed on to participate in that to prevent plastic waste from entering the oceans, and there are many things that this 40 companies are planning to do. They've already put their money where the mouth is and committed $1.5 billion to start tackling this problem. Mm-hmm. The third meta system that we want to change is food, land, and water. That's a big issue, right? We account for 25% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions, agriculture, 71% of the freshwater withdrawals, and we are also responsible for almost 75% of the biodiversity loss. So we need to fix the food and water system. We call it Food and Nature Program. So that's our third program. That's the third system we want to change. The fourth system that we want to change is urban mobility. We talked about urban mobility today. With more and more vehicles entering our roads and all of the attendant consequences, and as there's a revolution in urbanization happening in different countries. India is only 30% urbanized. China is now 51% urbanized. And if you look at China's history, when they hit the 30% urbanization rate, it just took off. The economy just took off. So you can see as India and Indonesia and Vietnam and Africa and Latin America are all urbanizing rapidly, you're going to have big manifestations of urban slums and urban infrastructure collapsing under the weight of migrants coming in from rural areas into urban centers.
Well, infrastructure, sanitation, the whole thing. Yeah.
And urban populations also have higher consumptive power. Urban populations, for example, consume 3 times more meat per capita than rural population, 2.5 times more dairy products than rural population. So we have to make sure that that urbanization is done in an organized and balanced way, and urban mobility solutions are found so that we can have a more sustainable mobility solution for the future. So that is our fourth program.
The fifth?
The fifth program is all about people, because with artificial intelligence, robotics, and digitalization, we are going to have roughly 120 odd million jobs lost. We're going to create 130, 140 million new jobs for the new economy. But the people who are going to lose their jobs might not be in the countries and in the sectors where the new economy jobs are being created. Say, let's take Africa. We used to have 7 workers required to process 1 bag of cashew from raw cashew nuts into blanched cashew kernels. Today, we can do it with 1 worker. So there are 6 workers that are now redundant. Mm. And many of them are women workers. There's no other alternative form of livelihood or employment for them. And the government does not have the finances or the resources to reskill and re-equip them with new skills required for the new economy, or have a social welfare net to take care of them. There isn't that. So the burden comes back to the employer, and he cannot just tell his shareholders, I cannot just tell my shareholders, I have saved 6 jobs, I have dramatically increased my productivity, but I have left 6 families without their livelihoods. Mm. And if the governments can't fill that gap, which they can't in these countries, we have a sense of responsibility to reskill them, bring them back into the labor force, whether we use them as an outgrow of farmers, whether we convert them into our suppliers and teach them how to be entrepreneurs and micro-entrepreneurs. That's the role and responsibility of a company, which in the past we said was a government job. Mm. It was a government role. We focused on maximizing wealth and creating more productivity and new jobs. And the government takes care of what the consequences are. We can't now say that.
Okay. So let's move on to the sixth and final one then. You said there were 6 things. We got
yes,
to 5.
Sorry,
the sixth one.
The sixth one is the scientists and the innovators coming up with those breakthrough solutions. Mm. And investment in innovation and technology today. If you look at the globe on an aggregate, only about $4.5 billion is annually being spent on agricultural food research, for example. We need at least $50 billion to be spent to find the next new productivity breakthroughs. That is why coming here today and going around the stalls and seeing the innovation in the food and agricultural system and the way Bula is trying to catalyze some of the stuff was very inspiring and encouraging to me. That's the kind of innovation that we need to find the next breakthrough solutions to address this problem.
Well, I know that people are very delighted, very happy indeed that you've made the journey and come here. Thank you for joining us. And sounds like you're going to be a busy man. I better let you go. Sunny Verghese, thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.